First, we will present few challenging cases from our department, which we had managed in the last few years. Then, after this, we will see the literature, what kind of the things available, published. And Department of Microbiologists, they will present their institutional data as well as some practical tips about how to collect appropriate samples. In the last, we will summarize what are the available guidelines in the diagnosis as well as in managing these cases. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Shreyas to present the cases.
Good morning, everybody. So the case one of the today's CGR session is a patient, 14-year-old male child with the diagnosis of acute pyelonephritis. A patient had a high-grade fever and right flank pain for 4 days and admitted to private hospital at Allahabad. His initial urine examination and ultrasound abdomen was suggestive of bilateral pyelonephritis and diagnosed with the complicated UTI. He stayed there for 5 days and managed conservatively. On day 5 of illness, the patient had oliguria and metabolic acidosis. He was conscious, oriented, hemodynamic stable, and required renal replacement therapy for the stay of the 21 days. On day 22 of the stay, he had an episode of seizure with respiratory distress. He was drowsy with vasopressor support and oxygen support with face mask. On day 25 of illness, he arrived at the nephrology department, SGPGI, and initial 48 hours, he was managed for the shock, hypoxemia, anuria, and his initial evaluation of ultrasound abdomen was suggestive of the enlarged bilateral kidneys with increased echo texture, abscess in the lower pole of the left kidney with hepatosplenomegaly. And non-contrast CT abdomen was showing the hypodensities in both the kidneys with bulky kidneys. After 48 hours, he was shifted to CCM department with the issues of circulatory shock, ARDS, and AKI stage 3 on renal replacement therapy. His ICU predictive mortality scores were the SOFA of 11 and PRISM score of 14 with the predictive mortality of 40 to 50% and 45% respectively. On day 27 to day 29, he was managed for the anemia, thrombocytopenia, coagulopathy, ARDS, and anuria with broad spectrum antimicrobial, vasopressor support, mechanical ventilation, and renal replacement therapy. His repeat ultrasound abdomen Doppler was showing the enlarged bilateral kidneys with absent blood flow in bilateral renal arteries. His shock worsened and he succumbed to his illness on day 31 of illness. His postmortem biopsy was showing the aseptic fungal hypa with acute angle branching. So to summarize this case, his course of 31 days, from day 1 to day 25, he was managed outside SGPGI. He presented to day 25 of illness to the nephrology department for 48 hours. On day 27 of illness, he admitted to our side, and within 4 days, he succumbed to his illness. He received amphotericin B for last 4 days of illness, and his risk factors in this case was prolonged illness, multiple antimicrobial, and septic shock. So case two of this CGR presentation is 22-year-old female with postpartum day 60 presented to gastromedicine ward with the pain in abdomen for 1 day. Her initial amylase and lipase levels were increased, and bedside ultrasonography abdomen was suggestive of bulky pancreas. So she was diagnosed with the acute pancreatitis. On day 3 of illness, patient had a headache with left eye proptosis, ptosis, and bedside fundoscopy revealed the papilledema. And MRI brain, MR venogram, as advised by neurology team, was suggestive of the left side cavernous venous sinus thrombosis. And she was started on therapeutic anticoagulation. On day 5 of illness, a patient had a random blood sugars ranging 550 to 750 milligram with ABG showing the pH of 7.15 with bicarb of 7 milliequivalents and anion gap of 25. On further evaluation, her blood and urine ketone levels positive. So she was diagnosed with the diabetic ketoacidosis and shifted to CCM department for further management. On admission, our issues were the acute pancreatitis with cavernous venous sinus thrombosis and diabetic ketoacidosis. and her predictive mortality score of SOFA of 9 and Apache score of 20 with predictive mortality of 33% and 40% respectively. Initially, from day 5 to day 14, initial 48 hours, she was managed for the diabetic ketoacidosis with fluids and electrolytes, and therapeutic anticoagulation was continued in view of left-sided cavernous venous sinus thrombosis. On day 14 of illness, patient had a 1 fever spike, and for further evaluation of sepsis, CECT abdomen was done, which was suggestive of the bulky pancreatitis with no obvious drainable collections, and empirically amphotericin B was added to her antimicrobials. On day 18 of illness, patient had an upper GI bleed. She was managed conservatively with the PPI infusion and laboratories showing the INR of 2 with APTT of 45.8 and managed conservatively with the blood products, and her therapeutic anticoagulation was stopped. On day 19 of illness, her upper GI bleed persisted. So with gastromedicine team, we have done the upper GI endoscopy, which was first arrow is showing the large ulcerated area, and second arrow is showing the black necrotic tissue. So with gastrosurgery team, we have done the CT angiography, which was the arrow is showing the rent in the posterior wall of the stomach. And further, she was planned for the laparotomy on the next day, and the intraoperatively surgeons has done the subtotal gastrectomy with the feeding jejunostomy and colostomy, and the gross specimen of the stomach subtotal gastrectomy was showing the black necrotic tissue. On day 25 of illness, the histopathology was available, which was showing the first image of periodic acid shift stain, was showing the angioinvasion, and second silver staining was showing the acute angle hyphae, and the next arrow is showing the angioinvasion. So to summarize this case of the 42 days of her illness, on day 1 of illness she appeared to the gastromedicine, and on day 5 of illness she admitted to CCM ICU. On day 25 of illness she was diagnosed with the mucormycosis, and her dose of amphotericin was increased, and it was changed to the liposomal amphotericin B, and enteral posaconazole was added. On day 42 of illness, she succumbed to her illness, and risk factors in this case was the postpartum state with diabetic ketoacidosis and pancreatitis. So now I would like to ask Dr. Anand to present the case 3 of this session.
Good morning to everyone. I'm going to present the case 3 in the series of a 56-year-old male patient of a post-COVID pneumonia sequelae. He presented with a history of fever, myalgia, and difficulty in breathing. In hospital in Kanpur, was a positive COVID RT-PCR positive, and diagnosed with COVID pneumonia. Subsequently, patient, there's a chest X-ray of the patient showing reticular nodular shadows suggestive of interstitial pneumonia. Subsequently, patient had a severe respiratory failure and was transferred to hospital in Delhi, and had severe ARDS, was intubated, and was on mechanical ventilator support, and treated with antivirals and steroids. A stay of almost 2 to 3 weeks. Patient was discharged home by fourth week on domiciliary oxygen and oral steroids. Patient had a stay of almost 5 days at home. He developed left-sided chest pain and respiratory distress. And patient was admitted in a hospital in Kanpur, and CT by HRCT thorax was done, which showed a left massive pneumothorax, and shown in the picture. An ICD was inserted, and patient was intubated in view of worsening respiratory failure, and the patient was tracheostomized there. Patient had a stay of almost 2 to 3 weeks in the hospital, and in view of weaning failure, patient was tracheostomized and was transferred to SDPGI. Coming to the course in SDPGI, on admission, issues on admissions were patient had prolonged weaning, lung fibrosis with hypoxemia, and neuromuscular weakness. SOFA score was 5 on admission, and with a predictive mortality of 20%, and Apache score was 15 with a predictive mortality of 25%. Coming to the course in SDPGI, during 8 to 12 week, patient had prolonged weaning, ARDS, and neuromuscular weakness. and was on and off vasopressor support and continuous mechanical ventilator support. And by 13th week, patient had massive upper GI bleed and had a severe circulatory shock and severe metabolic acidosis. Massive transfusion was done and a DSA was planned. And this is a DSA picture showing a splenic artery ruptured with the bleed and embolization with the metallic microcoils were done. But patient had persistent shock in spite of that, and mechanical ventilator support was continued. And in view of persistent upper GI bleed, upper GI endoscopy was done, but it didn't reveal any ulcers, but had a large clot. And patient underwent CT, thorax and abdomen, and it is showing a CT, CCT thorax was done, in which the stomach wall is not enhancing and it is adherent to the diaphragm, and you can see a pleuroperitoneal rent. So in view of ischemic bowel, patient underwent OT with exploratory laparotomy was done, and subtotal gastrectomy with FJ insertion was done. And this is a gross specimen showing necrosis of the bowel, stomach wall. And this is a histopath of the slide showing acute non-septate hyphae suggestive of mucor, and an antimicrobials were started. And by 14th week, patient pleural and peritoneal fluid microscopy showed broad aseptate right angle branching hyphae, and blood culture had a growth of E. coli, Klebsiella and Candida glabrata, and appropriate antimicrobials were started. By 15th week, patient had severe refractory septic shock and multi-organ dysfunction syndrome, and by 15th week, patients come to illness. Coming to the overall course of the patient, patient had a stay of almost 15, illness of almost 15 week, and was admitted on CCM by 8th week, and was diagnosed with disseminated mucor mycosis by 12th week, and his liposomal amphotericin dose was increased to therapeutic dose, and oral enteral posaconazole was added. In spite of the patient's come to illness by 15th week, and the risk factors in the case were steroids, malnutrition, and septic shock. Coming to the case 4 in the series, is of a 37-year-old female of acute necrotizing pancreatitis. Patient was a known case of hypothyroidism. Was on levothyroxine 100 microgram since 2016, and patient had a severe pain abdomen with recurrent vomiting, and amylase and lipase were increased, and USG and CT ultrasound abdomen and CCT abdomen was done, and patient was diagnosed with severe acute pancreatitis, and this is a CT film showing irregular the pancreas could not be made out, and diagnosis of acute pancreatitis was done, and patient was this is a course before SDPJ, and she had a stay of almost 40 days there, and patient had a hypoxemic respiratory failure and was on O2 oxygen therapy, and patient had acute kidney injury and was on renal replacement therapy. And after 40 days, patient was transferred to SDPGI, and issues on admission were acute pancreatitis, circulatory shock, and acute kidney injury, not on a renal replacement therapy. And SOFA score on admission was 4 with a predicted mortality of 10%, and Apache score was 16 with a predicted mortality of 40%. Coming to the course in SDPGI, by 6th to 7th week, patient had septic shock, ARDS, and acute kidney injury, and was on vasopressor support, and renal replacement therapy was stopped after one session. And by 7th to 8th week, patient was on persistent vasopressor support and mechanical ventilator support, and his general condition deteriorated, and CCT abdomen was done, and it showed a non-drainable collection were there. And subsequently, by 8th to 9th week, patient had a growth of unusual organisms in blood and ascitic fluid, as growth of Elizabeth species, and tracheal secretion and urine had a growth of Stenotopomonas, and a patient had persistent shock and mechanical ventilator support. And by 9th, in the course of 9 to 13th week, in view of a persistent hypotension and refractory shock, cortisol levels were done. It was very low, and a diagnosis of critical illness related cortisol insufficiency was done, and tracheostomy was done, and patient and steroids and were added, and patient was given multiple blood transfusion was done. And by 13th week, patient had a right hip abscess, which was drained, and the pus had a growth of Klebsiella pneumoniae and enterococcus. By 14th week, patient developed left facial swelling and with a complete eye ophthalmoplegia and ptosis. And blood, by 15th week, patient had a growth of Pseudomonas in blood, and CT PNS was done. This is a CT PNS showing left maxillary sinusitis, arrows indicating this. And patient underwent FES with orbital decompression with right sphenoidectomy with cleaning. And by 16th to 17th week, patient microscopic and histopathological diagnosis of mucormycosis was done of the sinus sample sent. And this is a past stain showing mucor, and this is a silver stain showing the mucor invading the blood vessels. And patient was started on liposomal amphotericin B and enteral posaconazole. And by 16th week, patient had fallen sensorium, and MRI head was suggestive of left basifrontal involvement. This is the arrow indicating frontal lobe involvement the patient mucor. And in view of recurrent infection by unusual organisms, we had immunological consultation done, and was diagnosed with common variable immunodeficiency, and had a very low absolute lymphocyte count, and globulin fraction was also low. And by 17th week, patient condition deteriorated, and surgery was deferred in view of patient was unfit for surgery, and patients come to her illness by 17th week. Coming to the overall, patient had a illness of almost 17 week and was admitted in CCM by around 6 week, and was diagnosed with rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis by 15 week, and her liposomal amphotericin B dose was increased to therapeutic dose, and enteral posaconazole was added, and patients come to his illness by 17 week. Coming to the risk factors in the case where prolonged illness, multiple antimicrobials, and on a prolonged steroid use and septic shock and renal replacement therapy. Thank you. I'll like to invite Dr. Srivats for a literature review.
Good morning. I'll be briefly reviewing the literature available on mucormycosis. First, we'll look at the diagnosed cases of mucormycosis from our ICU. In the past decade, around 8 cases of mucormycosis have been diagnosed. The age group varied from 10 to 56 years of age. The most commonly involved sites were renal and the gastrointestinal tract, and 2 cases of rhino-orbitocerebral type was diagnosed. In the first 2 cases, the diagnosis was made from postpartum biopsy, and in others, they were diagnosed during their course. We'll now look at the case reports from SDPJ on mucormycosis. The Department of Pathology published 3 cases of mucormycosis in young male. Our department reported 2 cases of renal mucormycosis in adolescent male. Nephrology department reported a case of mucormycosis involving the thyroid in a post-renal transplant patient. The neurosurgery department reported a case of CNS mucormycosis presenting as obstructive hydrocephalus. Another case series from the Department of Pathology to evaluate the clinical profile of mucormycosis involving the different sites. A total of 16 cases were done. The most commonly infected sites were renal and pulmonary system in our hospital. The most common predisposing factor in this cohort were diabetes mellitus uncontrolled and renal transplant status. The nephrology department published a case series of 10 cases of isolated bilateral renal mucormycosis in apparently immunocompetent patients. The cohort included 10 young male from rural areas. The mortality rate was 40%. Isolated bilateral renal mucormycosis have been reported only from India and China. A similar case series was published from PGH Chandigarh of isolated renal mucormycosis in immunocompetent patients. A total of 15 cases were reported. The most common presentation were fever not responding to antibiotics and flank pain. The mortality rate was 40%, similar to our case series. In 2019, Zhang and colleagues did a systematic review of case reports to study the epidemiology, clinical manifestations of mucormycosis. A total of 600 articles were reviewed and 851 cases were included. Diabetes mellitus was the most common underlying predisposing condition, and rhino-cerebral orbital form was the most common type in these patients. pulmonary mucormycosis was common in hematological malignancy patients and in patients who have undergone transplantation. In 2020, another systematic review of case reports to study the epidemiology, clinical features, diagnosis, and treatment of mucormycosis in diabetic patients were done. A total of 44 case reports and 18 case series were included in this. Facial swelling, headache, and loss of vision was the most commonly reported symptom. Amphotericin B, either in crystalline or liposomal form, was used as the first line of therapy universally. Surgical debridement was done in most cases. Posaconazole, either in oral or IV form, had a good therapeutic effect. Oral mortality, however, was 46%. The widespread use of glucocorticoids and COVID-19 have predisposed these patients to invasive fungal infection. A total of 18 case reports of mucormycosis in association with COVID-19 have been reported. The median age was 53 years of age, and there was a predominance of male population. The most common risk factors identified were uncontrolled diabetes and steroid use. Rhino-orbitocerebral form was the most commonly affected site. The mortality was very high, except in cases of isolated rhino-orbital involvement. Average time between the diagnosis of COVID and mucormycosis was found to be 10 to 15 days. Now, I'd like to invite Dr. Tasneem from the Department of Microbiology to talk about mucormycosis from microbiologist's perspective. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shiva. Good morning, all of you. I'm Dr. Tasneem Siddiqui, senior resident from the Department of Microbiology, and I will be discussing the lab diagnosis of mucormycosis from a microbiologist's perspective. So mucormycosis is the third most common cause of invasive fungal infection following candidiasis and aspergillosis, and the agents causing mucormycosis were earlier classified under zygomycota, and now they have been reclassified under the phylum Globulomycota with two main orders, that is the mucorales and the entomophthalates. The term mucormycosis is a misnomer because the most common etiological agent of mucormycosis worldwide is Rhizopus, of which Rhizopus arises is the most common species. However, recently there has been increase in the cases of Rhizopus microsporus and Rhizopus haemothalicus in the Indian subcontinent. And the first human infection case report of Rhizopus haemothalicus have been reported from our center. It is followed by rhizomucor, apophysomyces, lichthymia, mucor, cunningamella, syncephalestrum, succinia, and coccidiomyces. Apophysomyces variabilis is the important in case of isolated renal mucormycosis. Now, the agents causing enteromophthalmycosis, they conidiobolus and basidiobolus, they cause chronic subcutaneous infections. So if we look at the literature which has been published from India and rest part of the world, we can see that Rhizopus is the most common etiological agent of mucormycosis worldwide. However, in the Indian subcontinent, it is the Apophysomyces which is the second most common isolated genus. So what are the samples that need to be sent for a diagnosis? So it depends on the site of involvement as well as the extent of involvement. And however, biopsy or tissue sample is the gold standard for diagnosis, and all tissue samples for microbiological examination should be sent in sterile normal saline and not formalin. In case of rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis, tissue swabs are not appropriate samples. However, deeper samples, particularly the surgically debrided tissue with necrosed part and the punch biopsy, are most useful. In pulmonary mucormycosis, sputum samples are not appropriate as most of the time we get saliva. However, if we get a thick, well-explorated mucopurulent sputum, then it can help in diagnosis. However, deep samples like bronchoalveolar lavage, tracheal aspirates, and biopsies are a good sample. And we are able to diagnose renal mucormycosis in urine samples, but this sample should be a full voided 24-hour urine sample. And for cutaneous mucormycosis, it depends on the extent of the disease. So coming to the diagnosis proper, the main modalities are the microscopy and the culture. In microscopy, on 10% KOH wet mount, we can see the broad aseptate hyphae, which are ribbon-like in appearance, and they have got a wide angle or 90-degree angle branching. Similarly, on calcofloor white, we can see a bluish broad hyphae which are aseptate and they have got wide angle branching, and it has got a characteristic ribbon like folding. Now it needs to be differentiated from Aspergillus, which has got this thin hyphae with dichotomous branching. On Gomeries, Nithamine silver stain, we can see blackish and brownish fungal hyphae with wide angle branching. And in periodic acid shift, we can see the tissue necrosis, which is the hallmark of mucormycosis, along with magenta colored aseptate fungal hyphae with wide angle branching. Now, for fungal cultures are needed for identification and as well as for doing the antifungal susceptibility testing. So all mucolils, they grow very well in any carbohydrate containing media under normal conditions, and the growth is so rapid within 48 hours that it fills up the entire petri dish and causes lifting of the lid. Initially, the on culture, the appearance is of cotton candy in appearance, but as sporulation occurs, it gives a salt and pepper appearance. Fungal biomarkers like galactomannan and beta-D-glucan are of not of much use as beta-D-glucan is absent in the cell wall of mucorales. However, molecular diagnostic methods like polymerase chain reaction and MALDI-TROF are still in for research use, and they have not been validated for routine diagnostic purposes. So once we get the culture, we do a lactophenol cotton blue teeth mount of these cultures to better appreciate the morphology and identify these organisms. So this is the LCB mount of a rhizopus, where we can see a sporangiophore bearing a sporangia with the rhizoids. This is Rhizopus homothallicus, where we can see a brownish globose zygospore with dentate spine. This is the apophysomyces, where we can see the broadened apophysis giving it a champagne glass appearance, which is a characteristic of it. In Lichthymia, we have got a pyriform, a pear-shaped sporangia. This is a sporangia of a mucor, which is large and globose with spores in it. Rhizomucor is characterized by a branched sporangiophore with primitive rhizoids. In case of Cunningamella, we get a flower-shaped sporangiola. In case of Syncephalestum, these spores are stacked to form tubular finger-like merosporangia, and this is the flask-shaped sporangia of Succinia. So these are the cases of mucormycosis which have been identified in the mycology lab in the year 2019 and 2020, and here we can clearly see the dryno-orbital cerebral mucormycosis was the most common, followed by pulmonary and renal forms, and we have received the samples from all these departments. And all these cases were microscopically confirmed cases of mucormycosis. However, culture positivity was only seen in 60% of these cases. And the most common isolate was Rhizopus arisus, and we were also able to isolate Apophysomyces variabilis, Rhizomucor fusilis, Mucor and Lichthymia corymbifera. With this, I will conclude. Thank you for patience listening. And now I will call Dr. Mayank to discuss the diagnosis of mucormycosis from a clinician's perspective.
Good morning, everyone. Now we are going to look at mucormycosis from a clinician perspective. First, I would like to discuss a brief about the incidence of the disease, followed by the various modalities in diagnosis and treatment. Among the various causes of infection in critically ill patients, fungal infection constitute only about 13% of the cases. Among this fungal infection, invasive mold is only 14% of the cases, and mucorales constitute only about 14% of these invasive mold infections. So overall, the incidence of mucormycosis in critically ill patients is less than 1%. The incidence is rising globally, and it varies according to the type of cohort, the region and countries. This is a picture which is taken from a recent review which was published in the Journal of Fungi in 2019, which depicts the site of infection in various disease states and in various parts of the world. The inference of this study was the rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis is the most common site of infection, followed by pulmonary, and which is followed by cutaneous forms. The site of infection can also be classified according to the immune status of the patient. Like in immunocompromised patients with uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, rhino-orbital form is the most common, In patients with organ transplant and hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, pulmonary forms are more common. And in immunocompetent patients, the cutaneous and soft tissue infection are the most common sites of infection. The risk factor for mucormycosis can be classified into classical and non-classical form. The classical risk factors include neutropenia, cytotoxic chemotherapy for malignancies, solid organ transplant recipients on immunosuppressants, and hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. The other risk factors include uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, chronic steroid use, patient who are admitted with prolonged sepsis, patient of COPD, chronic liver disease, and chronic kidney disease. Now, in a susceptible host, inhalation and ingestion are the most common route of infection in immunocompromised patients. In immunocompetent patients, who underwent extensive burns, patients of road traffic accident, implantation and inoculation are the most common routes of infection. Mucormycosis is characterized by tissue infection with involvement of blood vessels or angioinvasion. This angioinvasion leads to this vessel thrombosis, and which ultimately leads to multiple infarcts and tissue necrosis. Now, the European Confederation of Medical Mycology, with experts from 33 countries, devised the global guideline for the diagnosis and management of mucormycosis, which was published recently in 2019 in the Lancet journal. According to these guidelines, to diagnose the disease, first we need to have a high index of clinical suspicion, because the disease is quite rare and has a high mortality. The suspicion can be raised based on the various clinical characteristics of the disease, and we can know the extent of the disease with radiological imaging. To diagnose the disease, we need the help of the microbiology as well as pathology teams. Now, the clinician suspicion can be raised based on the various characteristic features of the disease. Like whenever we see in our patient, there is development of necrotic tissue involving extensive area of the face, involvement of the nose, involvement of the sinus, involvement of the cheek, as well as the eyes, or there is a presence of eschar, we should suspect mucormycosis in our patients. The second image shows a 2-year-old male child with extensive involvement of the face, rhinoorbital cerebral mucormycosis, the involvement of the eyes. The third case shows a necrotic tissue which is adhered to the ulcers present inside the mouth. The fourth case is a young male who was involved in road traffic accident and had extensive necrosis of the skin over the exposed area. Isolated renal mucormycosis is quite common in Asian populations, especially in China and India. And the characteristic sign is the bulky kidneys with extensive multiple infarcts. The last image shows a resected segment of the stomach with extensive necrosis and presence of nodules. Now, the Department of Nephrology has published many reviews, as has been discussed earlier. And with the Department of Microbiology have devised a rapid screening test for patients with isolated renal mucormycosis based on the clinical features of fever and flank pain, the presence of gross hematuria in urine samples, and then they send these collected 24-hour samples for urine microsis where a diagnosis is made. The last image shows the passage of mucor bizarres in urine. Mucormycosis disease spreads contiguously to various adjacent tissues. It does not respect the anatomical boundaries. The first image shows an MRI of a patient in which the mucormycosis has spread from the paranasal sinus to the orbit and the left basifrontal region. This image is similar to the case 4 that we have discussed earlier. The second image shows an infective mass in the thoracic cavity, which has invaded the diaphragm and involved the adjacent abdominal cavity tissue organs. The third image shows an NCCT of the abdomen, showing showing bilateral bulky kidneys and multiple hypodense areas suggestive of acute infarcts. There are many characteristic features which can be seen in radiological imaging. These features are not specific for the disease, like the presence of halo sign, in which there is a central hyperdensity, which is followed by a ring of ground glassing, which is seen in mucormycosis. Just opposite to this sign is a reverse halo sign, in which there is a central ground glassing followed by a rim of hyperdensity. The vascular occlusion sign, in which there is a sudden vascular cutoff close to the mucormycotic lesion with no depiction of the vessel inside or at the margin of the lesion. Mucormycosis is notorious for rapid progression. This is a CT of lung at day 1, day 8 and day 15 of the same patient, showing a reverse halo sign. In this image, we can see that there is a rapid progression with involvement of almost the whole of the parenchyma of lung at day 15, showing the rapid progression of the disease. For diagnosis of mucormycosis, we need tissue samples either via biopsy, which can be CT guided or endoscopically guided, or post-surgery. The diagnosis can be made by direct microscopy, in which we can see Posi septate or aseptate hyphae, which are broad, ribbon-like, and with irregular branching, or via culture. Both are required for definitive diagnosis. Molecular methods like PCR or MALDI-TOF are not routinely available, and serological testing like galactomannan and 1,3-beta-D-glucan are not helpful, and if present, suggest an alternative diagnosis. Mucormycosis are emergencies. Whether it's a confirmed case or it's a suspected case, an urgent surgical debridement with clear margins should be underwent, and patient should be started on antifungal therapy as soon as possible. Surgical debridement with a clear margin should be done for disease control, for histopathological diagnosis and microbiological diagnosis. But there is a challenge in this, whether we should go for surgical debridement in a case without a diagnosis, and what would be the safe surgical margin in such a rapid and angio-invasive disease is still not known. Liposomal amphotericin B in a dose of 5 to 10 milligram per kg per day IV is the first line antifungal therapy for mucormycosis. The second line therapy includes triazoles like posaconazole or isavuconazole, which are available in both IV as well as oral forms. The duration of the therapy is still not known. It can be weeks to months, depending upon the clinical as well as radiological resolution. The disease is notorious for a rapid progression and a high mortality. The overall mortality rate of mucormycosis is more than 55%. The immunocompetent patients with involvement of skin or sinus infection, where a diagnosis can be made rapidly and rapidly treatment can be devised, the mortality is slightly lower. It's more than 45% in these cases. In patients with the pulmonary mucormycosis, the mortality is more than 75%. However, the prognosis is very grim for rhinocerebral and disseminated forms. In rhinocerebral mucormycosis, the mortality is more than 80%. In disseminated forms, it reaches up to 100%. The poor prognostic factors in various cases are a delay in diagnosis, uncontrolled diabetes, immunosuppression, malignancies, and the disseminated form of the disease with involvement of the CNS. So in summary, despite advances, there are challenges in diagnosis, there are challenges in management. However, to improve the prognosis, we have to rapidly diagnose the disease and devise treatment strategies with a multidisciplinary approach with involvement of the medical and surgical teams and with the help of radiology and microbiology teams. Now, I would like to acknowledge the various departments who are involved in the diagnosis and management of the cases of mucormycosis who are admitted in CCM in the last decade. Thank you. With this, I would like to conclude today's presentation.